Are we live? Yes, we are. Welcome, everyone, to the RSP Film Room, episode number 84. And joining me as a frequent guest of the Film Room, someone who enjoys picking on me relentlessly because I'm so innocent and helpless, Mr. Matt Harmon of Backyard Banter, of NFL.com, and of footballguys.com. Welcome again back to the show, Matt. Please don't hurt me.
It's good to be back in the electronic version of the Film Room after being live in the Film Room. Not 2 months ago now. I mean,
yeah,
it feels like 1,000 years ago that I was on the beautiful Grand Road Trip, and I do miss it. But yes, I was there live in person, and now we're back on the digital side of things.
Yeah, exactly. But it was fun. It was fun having Matt and Charlie come by here. You know, at least you tried to kidnap him and keep him here, which is like a first for a pet. So, you know, Charlie should probably feel a little honored, though. He did look a little scared, and I understood why. But
yes, he's definitely it was not the first person or the last that tried to steal him on the trip. But I can report that he, you know, made it back with me as he so desires.
Well, there we go. We tried to clone him here, but it didn't quite work out. So,
oh my God! If yeah. You can ever do that, please, please let me know. If there are any cloning experts tuning into the show, please let me know.
If you ever run into a movie called Multiplicity with Michael Keaton, then you'll understand how that worked out. But not very well. But today we're going to watch a player that I think a lot of teams will hope that they had a shot to clone one day when they see what he's able to do. And that's the prospect from Rutgers, who's now with the Miami Dolphins, Leonte Carroo. And Carroo's someone that, you know, I promised Jeff Lloyd, who is a frequent follower and has been a guest on this on Film Room before, he asked me 2 years ago to save Carroo for him. So we tried a couple of times to do a show, and it just didn't work out. We both had some things where we had to cancel, and it just never worked out. So, you know, in this case, I'm sure that, you know, I know that Jeff was actually excited to know that you were going to get a chance to profile him with me if we were going to have all people that weren't going to be able to do it. For him, you know, if he wasn't going to be able to do it, I'm sure that he was, you know, I know that he was jazzed that you were going to be able to be on the show with him. So tell me what your thoughts were about Carroo, you know, when you saw him at Rutgers and studied him a little bit.
Yeah, so he was one of the 21 prospects that I put through Reception Perception this year. So got to see a good bit of Carroo, and he was an interesting one. There were a lot of people higher on him than I was, yourself included, as well as a lot of the guys from like RotoViz who do a lot of work with production-based measurables, because I know he was really pretty much the engine of that Rutgers offense, which, you know, we could get into a whole other discussion about the value of that and this, that, and the other, but just focusing on the player himself, there's a lot of really, really positive attributes to like about Carroo. I mean, I think that he profiled as a really ideal complementary receiver, somebody that can handle a lot of the dirty work of the game. Good in contested situations, definitely has a physical mindset. He's got that short, squatty frame. I think he's about like just under 6 feet or right at 6 foot, but he's also probably about 211, 215, something like that. I can't really remember, but he's got that sort of compact frame, and he really plays like a bowling ball, like in route. He's very apt to use that physical nature. The one thing, of course, it's kind of a negative there, and I think this was reflected in his success rate versus just purely man coverage, was that in the kind of the intermediate portions of the route, that can struggle. He can struggle to separate because of that frame against longer cornerbacks, and that's something that's going to be exacerbated at the NFL level. But that's strictly a frame thing. But you can see him work around that in shorter and deeper portions of the route. Because he's, despite not being like an incredible athlete, he's very good at separating deep, and something that I think he can bring to the NFL team right away. But where he was probably one of the best players in this class was separating from press coverage. And I think that's something that we're going to, that, you know, we can get into that now, we can get into it later, why I think he was such a target player for the Dolphins. That's something that the team said in the press conference after selecting him, was he was a player we really wanted. They called him a target player, somebody they pinpointed and wanted to select. And I think it's because of that ability against press coverage.
Yeah, and we can certainly touch on a little bit of that now, and we'll see certainly a lot of examples of it as we watch a few games of Carroo at Rutgers. I mean, you and I both we're on, you know, we did a show where we watched Devontae Parker a couple of years ago, and you know, I know that we both didn't like what we saw out of him, both together and in separate studies of him that we've published about him struggling against press coverage and that manifesting with the Dolphins. So do you want to touch on that a little bit more?
Sure. So you mentioned when we were watching him, I believe we watched the game against Florida State from 2014. And that was probably the game that most exemplified, I think, both of our biggest concerns with Parker. Not that we both didn't like him. I think we both had him as a top five receiver in the draft class. But the one thing that we thought would take him a while to get going in the NFL was that lack of a variation of release moves. You heard a lot of people say leading up to that draft that, well, he only has one release move, but it works every time. But that doesn't fly so much at the NFL level. And those two savvier cornerbacks at Florida State, I think it was PJ Williams or PJ something, yeah, and Ronald Darby, who both were top four round picks that same year. Those guys were really able to defeat him, reroute him, and generally kept him off, kept him from separating from press coverage in that game. And so it was really an example of something that was a larger issue with Parker. And then, of course, he misses the entirety of training camp and most of the preseason with that foot injury, which only delayed his impact because it delayed those getting the necessary reps to vary up his release moves. So all in all, and we know he finished the season very strong, but a lot of those big plays came either lined up in the slot or aligned off the line of scrimmage at the flanker position. And I think that's going to be his long-term home. All in all, in his reception perception, he was, from his rookie year, he had the second lowest success rate versus press coverage that I've ever charted, hovering right around 34% success, which is incredibly poor. The only player that was worse than that was Devin Funchess, that same rookie class. That's Parker's biggest problem right now, and I think the team has already taken note of that. Like, there were reports this offseason that they wanted to move him more into the slot and therefore move Landry into that flanker position. And so there's a lot of moving parts there, but that's why I think Carroo comes in as a really important piece, because I think of those three guys, while he might not be the best of the three, and that's not what I'm implying, but I think that he can play on the line of scrimmage at the X receiver position, allow Landry and Parker to play off the line a little bit, and therefore get a little bit more of a cushion off of press coverage so that they can take advantage of their real abilities. So right now, that's why I think he's an important player for this team.
Yeah, I think that's very well explained. And I remember watching Parker against NC State and Miami and seeing him struggle mightily against press coverage, to the point where if you weren't really watching and understanding how routes work, and it was one of the first players I watched and consulted with Villanova's receiver coach and Ryan Flynn and asked him about what I saw on tape, and he verified exactly. He said it was that the issue that Parker was having on some of these plays, it may appear like the defender just caught up to the route and was able to, you know, make a play on the ball, or that the throw was late. But really what it was is that Parker, you know, really failed to get separation from the defender and move in a way to engage the defender and then separate from him. And it allowed the defender to stay on Parker and just kind of mess up the flow of the route and the timing, and be able to gain better position. And, you know, it's interesting to me because while I like all three receivers, it was fascinating to me that Miami drafted two guys who neither of them in Landry or Parker really got it done when it came to facing physical tight man coverage. And I thought Landry struggled a little bit with route running early on in his career when it wasn't from the slot, when he was at LSU. It wasn't really his forte. But these are, you know, good players. It'll be interesting to see how they scheme them. And, you know, I remember talking to Russ Landry at the Senior Bowl, and Landy was very high on Carroo, reminded him a lot of Anquan Boldin, a player that he was also equally high on while he was with the Browns staff as a scout. And the only reason that they dropped him from being a top five pick was due to the 40 time And that was, I think that was a higher end decision, not a scout decision. And that ended up, they ended up paying for that as well as in a number of teams did. With Carroo, one last thing that I wanted to address before we start watching him is it was something interesting that Jeff Risden said, who is, you know, a fantastic writer at Draft Breakdown and a variety of outlets that you would see, who made a comment about Carroo on Twitter yesterday when we announced that we were going to be talking about him. And it was to the effect of that, you know, he it seems like the thing that he does is develop a mysterious injury that takes longer for him to be able to recover. And this was something that I covered in the 2016 rookie scouting portfolio. And I just wanted to share it with my reader, with the listeners here, because he had three publicly documented concussions during his college career, and it's very possible he had a fourth concussion that wasn't made public. And the first one occurred in 2013 against SMU after he ran into a brick wall behind the end zone. And a month later, he suffered a second concussion against the University of Central Florida and missed the final three games. And they didn't really talk much about it, but the following practice, he was wearing a protective jersey as a precaution. So that should tell you right there that something was up and he was hurt more than just a concussion, or it was a very serious one. You know, that if it was the final three games and then the entire winter goes by and he's still wearing a protective jersey, that should tell you that was a serious injury. And then in 2014, he suffered a third concussion against Michigan. Now, I was told by someone who was connected to the program with Rutgers that Carroo wanted to stay at Rutgers in 2015 because he wanted to play a full season. He wanted to reduce any of the concerns about the concussion history. And according to, you know, to them, you know, obviously that didn't work out. And my NFL source, who's separate from that, said that there's a scouting report that was circulated that had Rutgers listed out for three games in 2013 with an upper body injury. And usually those comments from staff mean that it was a concussion with some neck involvement. At least that's his experience with how scouts read that, with how personnel executives read it. And it fits another team's medical opinion that he had a neck injury, which was why they had the no contact jersey injury. And then the other source who's connected to the team, you know, he's given me secondhand information before, and I'll say that again, this is a lot of this is conjecture, but I will say that he has been reliable before about talking about what's gone on with that program, including to the reasons why Carroo's suspension early in his final year there due to a domestic violence investigation, and the police ended up dropping the charges against Carroo. He told me weeks prior that this was what exactly happened, at least from the accounts that he was hearing, and it's been quoted in the media since that it was Carroo trying to basically take his girlfriend away from an altercation that was occurring, and he wasn't even present for. He found out about it, ran in there, and there's a bunch of things going on, and he pulled his girlfriend and carried her away, and his ex girlfriend had gotten pushed into a wall during a melee, and he had nothing to do with it, but. The mysterious injury last year was that he had suffered a high ankle sprain against Indiana, then aggravated the injury the following week against Ohio State, and then missed weeks against Wisconsin and Michigan. And that secondhand source tells me that he actually missed that Michigan game due to a concussion and not a high ankle sprain, which is pretty, you know, if this would be bigger news, I think, that if it were broken by a bigger outlet, and it would probably cause some sort of issues with a program for not documenting a concussion appropriately. And so, you know, it's one of those things that it's interesting to see whether or not that may be the case, but definitely the source says the three games were out with the upper body injury, the comments about the neck involvement, and that there was some concerns or notations on the medical report that he had some post-concussive syndrome. And so, you know, having those types of histories of concussions are probably going to drop a player in the draft. And according to my source, he said that he would have been surprised if Carroo fell out of the third round. But because most teams were like, they've seen this type of thing before. It wasn't a major concern, but it was enough to drop him about a round, round and a half. So that's the long version of that. But I just thought it would be interesting to note that this was that the mysterious injury stuff might have to do with the fact that they were trying to hide a neck injury and not really make a big deal out of it, when they weren't really hiding it as much as just, you know, I mean, it wasn't anything that needed to be, I think, listed because it was related to a head injury. But then the weird one in 2015 that might have actually been a concussion rather than a high ankle sprain is a really interesting one to consider there.
Well, and despite all of that, and that is a litany of injury questions, and you know, there was the suspension and the domestic violence charge, you know, despite all that, even on the surface appearing like a laundry list of concerns, if he fell, maybe a round or whatever, he still went in the third round. I mean, if it was a bigger set of concerns, I think we would have seen him fall to the fourth or fifth round, at least like in my evaluation, because I never viewed him as like a potential, you know, NFL star. So that already doesn't seem like he'd be a first, early, second round pick. I think he ended up perhaps he fell like a half a round or something, but it wasn't a big fall. So you'd think that stuff's not necessarily a major concern for NFL teams, or at least for the Dolphins, who traded, again, just to speak to how they valued him, they traded a third and fourth round pick in 2017 to get him, I believe.
Yeah, and by a lot of accounts, he seems to be a very upstanding guy. Contrary to what you know looked like was happening in the public eye. And then on top of that too, I mean, watching him at the Senior Bowl, I thought he was easily the most polished receiver in the practices before he left, because he tweaked, an injury and he left, and he wanted to be ready for the combine. And I think that was probably a smart move, but you can see how these range of concerns, whether you're very positive on them like I am, whether you're kind of got like Matt, who's positive on him and thinks he's a good fit, but may not be a star. And then maybe someone like Jeff, who I don't know how he felt about Carroo other than that he's worried about the injury issues. So we're going to watch Carroo, and if you are not familiar with the RSP film room, just let everybody know that the videos here posted at the RSP film room are not hosted on the server, and that the original video content is not considered to be the property of the RSP film room. The videos are considered to be used under the fair use doctrine of the United States copyright laws, Title 17 U.S. Code sections 107 through 118, and the videos are used on the site for editorial and educational purposes only, and the RSP film room and its staff don't claim ownership of any of the original video content, and the RSP film room and staff don't use said video clips in advertisements, marketing, or for direct financial gain. All the video content in each clip is considered owned by the individual broadcast companies. We're just watching, you know, highlight clips that are put together by Draft Breakdown, an awesome site for being able to study players. And we're going to talk about what we see and share what we've learned about the game, the position, and the player, and to you, the audience. So the first game we're going to watch is Carroo against Michigan State. Make sure everybody can see what we got up here. Y'all good to go?
Yeah, I can see it.
All right. Well, then let's get this running, and we'll see if this works well. Let's do half speed just to make sure, see if this works well. He's at the top of the screen. And we'll watch this one more time here. We get rid of our little advertisement on the bottom here. So we've got an inside shade already, a couple yards off the line of scrimmage. And, you know, you've got the nice lean off the ball, but the defender plays outside shade just right at the top of the, you know, right at the release. So he knows he's going to have some inside free with maybe a dropping defender. The defender stays up here with a tight end working the flat. And it turns into a nice, pretty easy looking pitch and catch.
Yeah, right. That looks pretty easy, and I think this is a good example of something that he does really well. Those kind of like shallow or deep post routes, I think, are some of his. And he's a funny player too, because I don't know how much we're going to be able to see it on these clips, but just especially further on down the field, I think because he has, maybe it's his frame, or maybe because he does have that really good forward lean, he kind of looks, I don't know, it's just different from other route runners. And sometimes that can trip people up, but, you know, you think of a player like Stevie Johnson, who also runs routes very unconventionally, but still gets great results. So, and I think that's something that we can kind of see. I don't know if we're going to see it from this clip or this angle or anything, but it's just something I wanted to point out.
Yeah, and I think it's a really good point. And on this particular play, what you see is it almost looks like right here, when he kind of chops down on this, that the defender lets up a bit, because I think he's also probably mistakenly looking at this safety or this man in the flat and wondering if he's going to come off this tight end and work to the ball, and it doesn't happen. It's just wide open for him, and that little hesitation might have been enough for there to be a little miscommunication in the coverage or to just be fooled. So, but it is interesting what you say, because I mean, sometimes it happens a lot in basketball. You can have players who almost seem kind of ungainly in the way that they run at times, and or they have a certain stride that just kind of confuses the opponent a little bit, because it is just that little bit different. Nice catch with the hands there. Nice, yeah. Lean for sure.
He's got good hands. He's got some of the better hands to me in the class.
Yeah, so here we are again. Little inside shade, tight to the line. Looks like it could be press early on, but he's going to back off into man and just kind of run with Carroo. And that's a mistake with this guy.
Mm-hmm. And I think those balls too are some of the better ones that he does well. I mean, in terms of just contested catches or catches with defenders around him, where he has to kind of track the ball deep, are things that he's good at. This is something where I think, you know, the Dolphins probably wanted that sort of ball tracking and deep ability with Kenny Stills, but they certainly did not get that last year. And whether he will bounce back in his second year with the team, you know, that remains to be seen. But it's something that Carroo, because of his ability at the line of scrimmage and in the deep portions of routes like this and tracking the ball well, is something that he can offer to the team too.
Yeah, and this is an underrated play when it comes to difficulty, because what you don't see in the first part, the first viewing of the clip, the first angle, is that after contact that you referred to, because right here, you know, his arms ripped at, his shoulders, you know, this back arm's pulled away, and he's still able to make the ball, even with kind of a trap here. He still plays, you know, he doesn't get distracted by the contact of the defender, and this is going to happen routinely in the NFL.
Well, and that's something that I think when you listen to people talk about body catching, when this is an important thing to note, that, you know, not like all body catches are not the same. And this is one where, you know, you can't be expected to execute perfect technique when the defender is grabbing it. Because you see Carroo has to slow up too, and again, track and adjust to the ball, and that gives the defender enough time to catch up on the route and, like, grab at that arm. But so he doesn't have really the opportunity to execute perfect technique here or anything, but again, gives the ball enough of a cradle to catch the touchdown, which, you know, that matters too.
Yeah, and think about it this way. Carroo could have done what a lot of young receivers do, which is completely stop and turn towards the ball and try to high point it. But at that point, he's going to give the number 36 room to run back and try and defend the ball without diving. But as Carroo keeps his distance and continues to run and then lean back to reach for it, he's giving the Michigan State defender only one choice, which is to dive and make some contact here.
Yeah, you know who does this really well, like exactly what we're talking about, all facets of it at the NFL level, is John Brown, who's, you know, one of the better deep threats in the league, obviously. He's really good about slowing down, like not trying. And he's not a high pointer. He's probably more of a guy that traps the ball on deep routes, but you see that's why that can be a useful skill there.
We got our quick slant here. We don't get to see behind the scoreboard what really happened on this particular play, other than let's see if we can see a little bit about the footwork here. I mean, you kind of just got an outside in turn. It's a tight turn, and it's just a nice tight turn against a defender playing off of his position.
Yeah, again, this is another one of the routes that he scores really well on in receptive perception. Just a guy that, you know, by taking that strong outside-inside move, he gets good separation on slant routes there.
All right, so we have him at the top of the screen, and he's not targeted there either, so we'll move on. All right, now we've got him a little tighter to the formation. And what you see a little bit there, I mean, it's nothing major, but I mean, you see one of the things I do like, and we talked about him being separating from press coverage, is he does know how to use his hands, and he's tends to be the first to kind of use his hands when it comes to a situation where he's facing someone. He's more the aggressor with his hands. And even here with that little slap, reaching out to do that, It's not a big thing, but it's a consistent thing with him, is that no matter the situation, I often see him attacking, which is a nice thing to see with a player at this rate of his development.
I feel like every time you and I do one of these film rooms, we end up talking about whether, like, the mentality of the receiver, whether he is the aggressor or, you know, whether he takes the fight to the defender or he lets the defender take the fight to him. And this is another example of the good side of that.
Yeah, even this, you see, watch him pump his arms a little bit faster here to drive off the defender there and turn. Again, it's an aggressive movement. It's kind of setting the tone. And then you just see him finish, and he's, you know, like you said, he's compact, sturdy. You know, you're going to have to hit him to bring him down immediately, or he's just going to push downfield with you wrapped around him.
Yeah, if you look at his reception perception results for after the catch, he was above the class average in making defenders miss, breaking a tackle on 60% of his percent of his in space attempts. So he's not necessarily, like, you know, one of the most dynamic guys with the ball in his hand, but he's certainly good at making, you know, just routine after the catch plays and giving you that extra yardage like we just saw.
Yeah. And we see it again right here. I mean, just the awareness to turn inside once he gets to the boundary. And I like, you know, elements of the route that are nice here. Again, you're going to have the nice body lean and the eyes downfield. Facing that off coverage to keep the defender from jumping the route too early and trying to get him to at least turn his hips a little bit. But once he has this much cushion, he knows that he can just turn, snap the head around, and make the catch. But the pad level's good. That body lean's really strong. These are little things that you don't always see from a lot of players, and it's ingrained in him knowing how to move.
Mm-hmm. I believe it was him, Sterling Shepard, of course, and Tajay Sharp were three guys that I pointed out this year that were some of the better, more advanced route runners in the class and would ingratiate themselves to their team pretty early on. And, I mean, Carroo certainly fits into that, you know, earning starter reps with Parker being out during OTAs.
Yeah.
You can see some of these things, like some of these more nuanced things, especially eye level and everything of that nature that are very appealing to NFL teams if they're going to trust a rookie early on.
getting that arm across the body of the defender here and getting it all the way behind, you know, and not just kind of slapping at it or going through the motions. That's a good example of a guy, again, who knows how to use his hands. And it's not just, oh, this is a technique I practiced and I've learned how to go through the motions. It's about where the hands and the arms need to be in order for him to use them correctly. And oftentimes it's reaching a little bit further than what you often see. And he does that here. He's got that arm all the way across the hip when he's working through it. You know, and he's taking advantage of the coverage here in terms of, you know, the position of the safety in the corner in this area. But I mean, he's doing what he's supposed to do, even with this tight catch to his chest, looks it into his hands.
Yeah, it's that sort of deliberate arm movements, and not to mention too, strength plays a part here. You know, I think when you posted the picture yesterday that we were watching Carroo, I think one of the comments we got back on it on Twitter was like, man, I love how ripped his biceps are. And, you know, I'm jealous too, as somebody that's consistently trying to consistently spend a lot of time in the gym. He's got great arms. He's ripped. And I think you see that there too, being an extra advantage, not only with the good technique of the timing and very deliberate nature of the move there, but also just the strength to push that defender back in the zone and then keep going. And yeah. I think, you know, that's strength is one of the underrated parts of playing the receiver position.
Yeah, I mean, Michael Irvin had a Hall of Fame career doing it. Roddy White had a terrific career before his ankles went down. He was a college wrestler. I mean, I don't think he was a college wrestler. I think he was a high school wrestler, but he was a very good wrestler and always very strong. And that's who I compared Carroo to in some ways, but I think that White probably had a little more speed.
Yeah. Oh, man, let me tell you, Irv still looks good seeing him around the NFL campus. He still looks ripped.
Right? Yeah, that's a guy. I remember Greg Cosell having a conversation with him, and he talked about Michael Irvin had the strongest hands of anybody he had ever met. And it was just like when he put his hands on you to demonstrate a technique, you literally would – he would just – you felt like you were about to get thrown around. And he said it wasn't even – and it wasn't him like trying hard to do that to you. He just had that kind of – you could just feel that kind of strength in his arms.
Mm-hmm.
So here we go. We got him in the slot, split just inside the numbers here on the right side. And he's just trying to find an opening against the zone and work with his quarterback. I like that, you know, he makes the effort to block and get position and turn inside. So, again, just the coordination and ability to read his quarterback, to read the spacing with the defender that he was working against, and to be able to work that out so that the defender never even touched the quarterback. Again, a little more than what you ask, what you expect from a player at his age. It's not going to win you fantasy titles, but it may. It does get him on the field and gives him a little bit more of a shot. Right, so we got our design roll. You know, and in this tape, you know, none of what we're looking at is like spectacular. You know, there's no huge displays of athletic ability here.
Well, that's not who he is. I think that's an important point. But again, another strong hands catch there. That's not who he is. That's not what he's, that's not, you know, where he wins Josh Norris hat tip. But it's an important role. You know, he's not going to do anything spectacular, but those, you know, but he's still winning chunk passes. He's still picking up, you know, chunk yardage here.
Yep. And on this play, I mean, let's watch again. You see you get the arm over here and try and slap down the defender's arm. You're going to see that with the inside arm about right there, kind of work over top and try and slap down. And he gets ahead, but on this one, it looks like he he's still moving backwards here, and rather than really attacking the ball.
Yeah, and this also kind of is a play that I would say demonstrates some of the things that I was talking about at the onset about his length and how some cornerbacks might be able to disrupt him, you know, especially longer guys. I'm not familiar with 36 here from Michigan State, but, you know, he's able to get his hand in there and break up. And it's a nitpicky play because, of course, it's, you know, he's still in pretty good position, but I think that's just that's something that we're going to see limit him a little bit if he's ever facing the top level corner on the opposition on Sundays.
Yeah. And, you know, if I were nitpicking him if I were going to play or pretend I was a receivers coach, you know, I would look at this play and there's two things that going on here. One is that throughout this game, he's had big plays and multiple catches where he's leaning back. He's still running away from the ball and turning back for it. So it's easy that when you've had success on routes, even different ones, where that's happening, that it primes you for committing that kind of mistake in a situation where you shouldn't be leaning back. And then with a fade route, you're also probably expecting the ball at a certain level. This ball's a little on the short side. And he also doesn't fully extend. He also, you know, he's leaning back on this play. He, you know, this is a play that you would have hoped that maybe he could have planted and attacked a step earlier. But because he's not even, you know, when he does make that play on the ball, he can only get 1 foot even barely in bounds here. So some of it is positioning too with the route that can be corrected.
Yeah, it's not, like you mentioned, it's a little bit of a low throw. It's not, that's something that he did also have to consistently deal with that at Rutgers was, you know, not the best quarterback play.
Yeah, I mean, so it's, I think the length thing is I think it's completely valid point about him. It's just also, you know, is he going to have a quarterback who's going to put it where it needs to be? And the quarterback's going to know where Carroo likes it and will probably give him a lot of opportunities to make plays that way. Carroo's just going to have to do a better job of, you know, really finding situations where he can use his body, use his size and his sturdiness to his advantage and getting that position to where he's forcing the defender to commit a foul or he's going to make the catch. I believe we've got one more here that we're going to get to see after.
And there are those guns again.
Yeah, right. making Harmon jealous here.
I'm going to go to the gym right after this is over. I got the headband on. So
that's see, there you go. Get a little inspiration from Leonte Carroo. And again, he's not even involved on this particular play. So let's go ahead.
You saw him get off the line of scrimmage there a lot. And I think, like on that last play, and I think that like you saw him chopping the arms there a lot. And that's one of the kind of quirky ways that he doesn't look like as much of a traditional wide out running routes. But I think it's also part of the ability of why he's able to get off the line of scrimmage cleanly so often.
Absolutely. So let's go ahead and put in the Maryland game here from last year. See what we've got here, and I think this will probably do us pretty well. And he doesn't even really look like a big guy. He just looks like he looks more like a running back at times, you know.
Yeah, he's squatty. I mean, he's muscular, obviously. I'm going to keep coming back to that. Now I'm starting to get a little weird with it. But he's obviously built well. He's a little bit more compact. And, I mean, I think that's also just how he plays the game, too, is that kind of like a running back's mindset. Not that, again, he's dynamic or anything, but using strength and positioning and the lean that we keep talking about, too, that's all like running back-ish wide receiver traits.
Yeah. Let's see if we
fool the cameraman here.
Yeah, right. Everybody got fooled there.
Yeah.
All right, so let's move it forward here. There's nothing we're actually. He did catch that, so we're going to take a look at it. And again, nice high point at the tip of the ball, front tip.
Yeah, and this is something that, you know, again, coming back to his role in Miami, Jarvis Landry is a good receiver in traffic. Parker shows the ability to high point the ball, and I think that it's something that they want. Again, they wanted to get out of a deep threat in Kenny Stills, but they didn't necessarily get that, and I think that, like, that again, that downfield high pointing with defenders near him, that's something that's going to be valuable to them, too.
Yeah, and if you ask me, I mean, the problem with Kenny Stills isn't his talent, it's his work ethic. And,
yeah.
And that's why New Orleans was like, we like him, but if we get a chance to get a pick that we – the picks that we
got,
let's go ahead and do it because we had concerns about him consistently working. Now, on this play, again, we got a little bit of tight coverage here. And it's placed right where it needs to be. And the defender, again, probably isn't quite – was probably caught looking a little bit as and not timing the ball as well. Let's see if we can see that again. He's absolutely comfortable, you know, leaning into the defender and working outside. Got his hand into the chest of the defender there. A little bit of a, I'm going to, as I'd call that, as you know, maintaining separation, you know, or kind of maintaining the boundary. Some defenders might call that a push, but it's kind of more of a hand check.
Yeah, that's not a push.
Yeah. Jordy Nelson's great at that.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's the little things like that that's hard to separate from NFL defensive backs, and if you can give yourself a little extra space, especially in the end zone, that is very valuable.
So I guess my concern is, you know, you talked about the Dolphins and their receivers. You know, what happens if he's the only guy on this team that can separate from press coverage?
I mean, I think that's why they want him to play the X receiver position. I think that, well, I certainly think, you know, Jarvis Landry is consistently creating blood wars on Twitter. there's half of Twitter that thinks he's the worst thing in the world, and the other half, I don't even know. I mean, I guess some people obviously really like him, but, you know, to me, and I'm actually going to finally contribute to this war. I'm going to chart out his 2015 reception perception. I have his rookie year data, but I haven't done his sophomore year yet. But I think the one thing that we can all agree on is that they don't need to funnel 160 targets to a slot receiver like Landry. You just even looking at, I wrote a piece for NFL.com, just looking at the pieces or the offenses that funneled through the slot receiver last year. And a lot of them, the trend was a lot of them were really bad offenses. It's not the type of, those aren't the type of players that you want to run your offense through. You need more outside guys. So, well, I think Landry is fine with, like, I don't really have any questions about him per se. I think he just kind of is what he is. They need somebody to emerge on the outside. And if he can do that better than Parker, I think that's going to get him on the field right away. Maybe not at the expense of Devontae Parker, but certainly in a complementary type of way.
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of – it's interesting to me because it was surprising to hear this week that there has been kind of a blood feud with Landry. It, to me, the player that I would think that people be questioning – and still be divided on was still Jordan Matthews, you know, but I guess that when the Jordan Matthews experiment that was much ballyhooed this winter ended as called prematurely in the spring and that, oh yeah, he's still a slot receiver. I guess that didn't quite work out as we thought. You know, that's the guy that I'd be more worried about long-term in terms, you know, because he's going to need that fit. Landry, I think I just kind of thought everyone knew he was a slot receiver, you know, and to me, it's, you look at that Miami offense, and I think the reason that they had to go through him as much as they did is that their offensive scheme really needed a lot of work. I had Will Hewlett on here, and he told me that he had heard that Miami scheme, you know, their route concepts there were calls for the same type of routes, but at different depths, and the receivers just had to intuit what the depths were in order to run the right route. So to me, that says the quarterback may understand where he needs to go, but the receivers might not. And if all else fails, well, let's just throw it to the slot guy because he's most likely to be the most open. If the rest of the guys are confused about what the route depth should be, you know, and they're not on the same page with the quarterback.
Well, and I think that's something that we've seen throughout Landry's time there, is that his game really jives well with Ryan Tannehill's. And you mentioned that when all else fails mentality. And I think that's something that when you're just looking at raw target data and distribution, you can kind of miss a little bit that, you know, maybe Landry's not the first read on every play, but he is the only one that's open because he's running those shorter routes. And that's, again, why he got over 160 targets last year. So I think that number is going to come down, not by an astronomical amount, but if they have more guys like Carroo or Parker that can separate at different levels of the field where they did not have that last year, then I think we won't have this blood war over Jarvis Landry because, you know, we just won't. Again, I don't know who views him as like a superstar level receiver, but maybe it's some of those damn big media outlets.
Yeah, I don't know. But it's interesting, you know, I mean, I look at Carroo and one of the concerns I have right away as I watch some of these throws that are going to him is that Ryan Tannehill really hasn't proven to be a great deep ball quarterback, I don't think.
No, I think he's proven to be a little bit of the opposite.
Yeah, so, you know, can Carroo be a bad ball receiver? It looks like he can be.
Say that the last two deep threats that Tannehill has had there, Mike Wallace, who is not really the type of player like we're seeing with Carroo that can track the ball in the air, win in contested situations. And so that marriage clearly didn't work out for that reason. But Kenny Stills, obviously, we've talked about the questions with him and work ethic and things like that. So perhaps – you mentioned being that accuracy or the bad ball receiver, the accuracy eraser. Perhaps Carroo can be that guy.
I've just kind of looked at Carroo as a player who maybe not this year or next year, but maybe long-term, regardless of who the Dolphins have at quarterback long-term, might end up being a good player because of the fact that he might be the last man standing on that Dolphins receiving core if everything goes south. You know, I could see him as the type of guy that a team looks at or like a new regime looks at and goes, well, Parker's been a disappointment, you know, great athlete, but relies too much on his athletic ability. Landry, we don't really want to play a lot of slot receiving. We don't want to be heavy on the slot receivers. This might be our guy. And it may be one of those things where it's not, you know, again, you mentioned it. I mean, he could be your consistent 1,000, 1,100 yard receiver, you know, in the pros with, you know, mediocre quarterback play. But he's probably not going to be your, you know, 1,400, 1,500, 1,600 yard player. If he has one of those years, it's probably going to be on a loaded team with a quarterback where he has great rapport.
So when you see here on this route, something that, you know, we've kind of hit on again, without great athleticism, why he's able to make these big plays. And, you know, he takes advantage of the cornerback here with that short shuffle. And I mean, he's got great feet, like to be quite frank, he's got very good feet at those break points and, you know, really good agility there and technique, the stop and start business in the route there. And that is why he's able to create such good separation on deep routes like that.
And it's very underrated because this is just a little move right here. But the way it's so fluid in the way that he did it, that he didn't have to exaggerate much with his body. Yeah. And what was funny to me is watching him at the Senior Bowl, his footwork, like most of what we've seen thus far doesn't even compare to what I saw him do footwork wise on routes against defenders, you know, in practice.
Yeah, it's such a subtle thing. You can almost miss it the first time. You can almost, you know, not even see him make that little move there. You just, and just, oh, I just ran past that guy. But it's that little stop and start there that makes the whole thing work.
Yeah. And with the knees still staying up the way that they do, it kind of mimics the stride still.
Yeah. Well, because you see the defender come bite down on it, and then it's like, whoops, he's past me. And again, it slows up, has to stop, you know, it doesn't get hit in stride or anything, and that's all part of probably what he'll be playing with Ryan Tannehill and his deep ball abilities.
Yeah.
He's not just going to get hit streaking down the field, otherwise the Mike Wallace thing might have worked out better than it was, because that's the type of deep ball receiver that he is. So I think that this is all important stuff to note on his film. Well, somebody else actually did something.
Yeah, right. All right, so we're going to see him at the top of the screen here. An offset eye look. And this is, again, a nice display of his footwork and use of his hands. And in multiple ways, actually. So yeah. It's a beautiful play. But look at the feet. I mean, he's got this nice little stutter outside in, then back outside. So he's kind of gotten out in, out move. Off of like basically a four-step release. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then just kind of, and then using the arm to get by.
Yeah. I mean, man, like this is the exact type of play that we're talking about for why we're theorizing that they made him such a target player. Because, you know, he shows everything that you want. In terms of separating from the line of scrimmage there, getting those, like, a variation of release moves that, you know, a guy like Devontae Parker doesn't have.
Yeah.
This is a perfect example of what we're talking about, like the overarching theme of why he fits in so well with this receiver core is currently constructed.
Yeah, this type of foot movement you see, I used to see this a lot with the Colts receivers, with Peyton Manning. You would see you know, variations of moves like that. And then, of course, you know, he just makes his catch look easy.
Yeah, right. Again, tracking the ball. It's super important. You think it's like a natural thing. Like, oh, yeah, you watch the ball into your hands. It's not that easy when you're going at full speed and also, you know, working through your routes and everything. But, yeah, I mean, he does make this look pretty easy.
And he's, you know, as squatty as he is, he's a pretty flexible, fluid athlete.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, it's a frame thing. It's not a athletic ability thing. Although, you know, he's not a great athlete, but just fluidity and flexibility, you know, he certainly is able to contort himself well.
You know, I kind of have a theory about guys like this, that if they can play at a high level technique-wise, they tend to have longer careers than some of the big-time athletes. They're kind of the slow and steady kind of players in the NFL, or the very just, you know, kind of like the Keenan McCardells or the, you know, guys who have 14, 15-year careers that are really strong, but they were never like the guy that you always heard about that was at the top of the NFL, but when he was on your team, you were really glad that he was on your team.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think that's exactly the type of player that Carroo is that sort of, he's going to have a long career and be very sneakily productive. He might not ever win you fantasy titles or anything, but he's going to win the Dolphins some drives for sure.
Yep. All right, so moving onward here. Let's see. We got him at the top of the screen here, tight to the right. Running kind of a sail route here. And nothing. All right. Let's see what else we got next. Slot. And I like the fact, you know, they did move him around a fair bit.
Yeah, I would certainly say the majority of the snaps have definitely come with him, you know, foot on the line of scrimmage.
Yes. There
for sure. Which, again, you know, it's something we've hit on and why he's an important player for them.
But that's a positive. I mean, because when you think about it, Kelvin Benjamin a few years ago, rarely did you see him at the line of scrimmage. And now they have two receivers who rarely you would want at the line of scrimmage, at least until they improve their ability to handle physical coverage. And it's interesting to me that they're both big physical guys in terms of how they look, but not how they play.
Well, I think Kelvin Benjamin, in contrast to Funchess, who, you know, we're also talking about there, I will give credit to, I think that I had those same concerns with him coming out, but I think one of the reasons that he was able to get on the field so early and perform pretty well for a rookie receiver early on was he was much, much better against press coverage than I thought he was. His rookie year reception perception scores for against press coverage, not necessarily everything else, but against press coverage were some of the better ones that I have.
Excellent.
So that was something that he really improved on. And I mean, if you know anything about if you know anything about the Carolina Panthers, you know that Cam Newton loves Kelvin Benjamin. Loves Kelvin Benjamin. For all his flaws, he does. Those two are boys, that's for sure. And I think it's because he's, other than Steve Smith, has never played with a receiver that can beat press. And I think Kelvin's the only one that can do that.
Yeah, again, nothing flashy, but you're seeing a guy, you know, it's quietly impressive in terms of footwork, the handwork, the ability to vary different techniques and his adjustment to the ball and the strength that he has as a runner after the catch. He's not Terrell Owens, but he's effective. And if you don't bring it to tackle him, he's the type of player that can cause you headaches.
Yep, that's for sure. That is, yeah, he's got a lot of bull mentality after the catch.
All right, so we get to see another opportunity maybe against, thought maybe there'd be some press there. But, you know, again, the aggressor in the run game, you see this often where he's the one reaching his hands out, trying to get contact, trying to grab first. He's not reacting to a defender doing it to him. All right, so let's see. And so at the top of the screen, let's see if there's anything happening on this one. And nothing.
Nice fadeaway from pressure there. I know he didn't see the total pass go his way, but he definitely drove through the cornerback there.
Definitely bowled through him right here. Yeah, sometimes that's what you got to do.
Yeah.
Gotta look at it one more time here. And he takes him off his feet.
Yeah, we can't see what the result of that route was, but, I mean, sometimes that is what you have to do is just drive through the cornerback. And whether that brings you separation or maybe it even brings you a penalty called against the defender, that's a strategic thing to do.
I'd call this more of a desperation throw, but let's see. Again, pads low, head down. And he tries to bring that hand over top. So I like the fact that he gets his arm over both of the defender's arms to try and get some position. But he draws the interference penalty here. I mean, look at this. And a lot of that really is about early positioning, because he beat him early on this play right here. Look at him squeeze that in there like that. That's actually a very nice play right here. And that's what gets him, because this defender at this point, he's like, I'm holding on for dear life, because if I let go, I'm swatted aside.
Yeah, you're definitely right about that.
And to be able to do that in tight quarters, this is the thing that might be very worthwhile for him, is that if he can show this ability consistently, where it's like, okay, I'm in tight quarters, but I still know how to get in there like that, like a wrestler does, you know, where you can operate in, or an MMA fighter, you know, that ability to use your hands and not just get neutralized because you're in tight quarters, that's going to be something. If it translates for him, he's going to be very effective, or at least he could be very effective with a quarterback who's confident in targeting him in those situations. And that's something that I'm not sure Ryan Tannehill will show.
Now, perhaps with a receiver who's more adept at it, he might feel.
Yeah. It might be argued that the most physical receiver he's played with was at Texas A&M. This guy by the name of Jeff Fuller. I think it was Jeff Fuller.
That's a little before my time.
Yeah.
Should you have limited my time.
But there you have it. So, yeah, that's our look at Carroo. Certainly an interesting player. He's kind of quietly – you can see his game is – he's a little bit more on the quiet side in terms of athletic ability, a little more understated. And we're going to find out, you know, whether or not that understated ability means that he's a little bit more understated than my bullishness on him, or whether or not that, you know, some of those little things may translate well enough that he can surprise. But it was definitely an interesting look with him, you know, in terms of what he – some of the little things that he shows, and it just tells you how projection is important sometimes when you're watching tape, because of the fact that it's, you know, he didn't show you anything from that high-end physical standpoint.
Well, it's so funny too, for a couple of thoughts here. It's so interesting to go back and look at college players after they've been drafted with the lens of how they fit and what their current team might have seen in them to make them a relatively high draft pick, because we often don't do that. You know, once the draft is over, then it's, you know, on to preseason and on to fantasy projections and this, that, and the other. But it's so interesting to go back and look at a player like Carroo and pretty clearly see, for multiple different reasons, whether it's his ability to track the ball, play in traffic deep, or his ability to get off the line of scrimmage against press coverage, pretty clearly see what the Dolphins probably saw in him to make him a pretty high draft pick. And secondly, I would say that sometimes in dynasty drafts, we get pretty caught up with, well, he got drafted to a bad situation because there are two established players ahead of him. But so often, you know, it is important to project how things that we were talking about in this video, you know, how he might be important to the team's offense and why he might be a very critical role player. And I don't say that as a pejorative term, why he might be a very critical role player for them. And perhaps he's been underrated in rookie. I would argue that he has been underrated in rookie drafts, and he's probably slipping too far because people are scared of, you know, Parker and Landry being there. But it's pretty clear that if he continues to accelerate the drumbeat that he's already started in the early portions of the offseason activities, that this could be a player that works his way into the rotation, you know, right away. And I don't know about you, Waldman, but I would rather take – I think I would rather take Leonte Carroo in Miami especially at his asking price, over Tyler Boyd in Cincinnati. Even if the opportunity doesn't necessarily on the surface seem as juicy as it might for Boyd. But I think long term, I think we're looking at an important player for Miami's offense.
I would agree with that. I mean, I was thinking about what you were saying and then thinking back of what we just watched with him. And, you know, he'd fit in. There are certain schemes where I thought he'd be really a nice fit. He'd be a good fit in a very classic West Coast type of offense because of his physicality and route running prowess. And then I just started thinking about a player who used to be with the Dolphins at the tail end of his career, Greg Jennings. And I remember when Jennings came to Green Bay, and at that time they had, Donald Driver, who was coming off of some wide receiver one caliber production efforts for a few years. And then they had two guys that were promising athletes. Robert Ferguson, who a lot of people were really high on his athletic ability, who had never really turned the corner because he just wasn't technically sound. And Corn Robinson, who wasn't extremely fast, but a lot of people, you know, he had one huge season in Seattle, and then that was just kind of it because he couldn't catch the ball. He had issues just hanging on to it. And, you know, Greg Jennings had a 600-yard season as a rookie. And then the following year, you know, Jennings ended up starting that, you know, had a 900-yard, 12-touchdown season. And then for the next 3 years after that, he was between 1,100 and 1,200 yards as a receiver in that offense. And, you know, you're looking at a guy who's 5'11", 195. He's quick, really quick player, but not unbelievably fast. And it really had a nice, you know, start to his career. So it'll be interesting to see how this all pans out because oftentimes we get enamored with the player. You know, Cordarrelle Patterson was supposed to be a great player coming out, and a lot of people were kind of split on him, but there were those that were unbelievably high on his athletic ability. I was. But his ability to release from coverage was such a liability that here we are today. This is his last year in Minnesota. If he doesn't blow people away and earn a contributing role and play big when he's on the field, they're not keeping him. You know, they're just not. It's not he hasn't done enough to be able to warrant that, and he's going to be experimented on. You know, he's going to be an experiment for another team that's going to probably try and kind of cater to what his deficits are rather than try and force him to get better. And, you know, he even mentioned himself that he didn't work hard enough early on in his career. And we see that often with a lot of players. Michael Clayton, a slower guy who was from LSU, who was a big guy who had a great first season, but then went to the clubs too much, and he ended up, you know, he looked like a shoo-in as a really good possession receiver with high-end production in the red zone, and his career went to nothing. So it's just a fascinating thing how this all turns out, and I would be I'm still a little wary of Devontae Parker. I love his upside, but, you know, I still look at him and think when someone asked him about his playing style and playing skill, he said, I lean on my God-given ability. And as a, you know, again, I'm overanalyzing this a bit, but it's a layer of information when you look at, you know, what he has to learn and what he's not good at. And it's like, I hope he's not still leaning on that because he's going to lean right out of the league if he does.
And it's not you necessarily overanalyzing it because it's what he displayed on the field in college and then again in the pros. And I know we know he finished strong statistically, but – you know, it takes defenses, what, like 4 weeks to catch up to a thing that's happening? And I think that when they go back and see some of the things that really were exemplified in his rookie year reception perception, and of course he can get better with more seasoning and more development, which he lost a lot of time to because of his foot injury. But there's already a report out of Miami that he's struggling in off-season practices. Well, again, he's hurt again, but he's also struggling to separate in practice. There was a report about that last week, I believe. So, you know, it's just something to be wary of we're not saying, I don't think either one of us is saying that Parker is, you know, he's going to bust or Carroo is going to pass him or anything like that. But, you know, we're saying that he, you know, Carroo is probably the safer player. He's certainly the more easy to translate to routine NFL routes and everything that comes with that. And again, that's why he's going to be an important player for them.
Exactly. And Parker flashed enough that you've got to be excited about him. But at the same time, I mean, honestly, I wouldn't be surprised if it just doesn't work out for him because of those very reasons. If we continue to see that he's getting hurt all the time and he's not getting any better at what he's supposed to get better at, that tells you that this player is not completely aware of the habits that he's going to have to display to improve. You know, and that's something that we see with people at this stage of their development often is just a lack of general awareness because they see, oh, well, I made the team. I'm making lots of money. Everyone's talking about me. I must be good. Right. You know,
and it's something we saw last year that he told, there was some report that he told a media member or told somebody in the team that he was going back to watch his old Louisville games just to remind himself that he was good. And that was like midway through the season. So, you know, it's something to watch out for. And it's something to not like overrate for this year. You know, he's already being drafted as like a fourth or early fifth round pick in these NFL 10 leagues. I mean, I wouldn't go near him. I wouldn't go near him for that price. And, you know, he's because he finished strong and we're going to see plenty of the, we're going to see that catch, that fantastic A-plus catch that he made against the Ravens, played over and over and over again on TV leading up to the season. People are going to draft him in casual leagues, probably even higher. So, you know, this is the same. This is a very similar thing to what we saw with a guy like Davante Adams last year. Made a couple of big plays. People extrapolated that to think he had a very good rookie season. But then when he was asked to do too much, more than he was capable of because of injuries to the players ahead of him, I mean, he had a disastrous season. And that's not even to say that Davante Adams is a, you know, a piss poor NFL receiver. It's just you can't ask too much of these guys. You can't put more on their plate than what they are. And I think to ask Parker to be a 130 target X receiver in Adam Gase's offense is more than what he's capable of doing.
Yeah, and I think that what you've summed up there very well is that it's one of the biggest biases that people have when they grade players is that they see that athletic ability flash and they completely throw everything else out the window because they're like, but he did this, mm-hmm. but look what he can do, but look what his upside is. And it's just like, that's fine. I mean, you can have a kid with great agility who's riding a bike for the first time and hits a bump and, you know, flies and lands on his feet. And you could talk about how he's a future acrobat, or you could say that, you know, he's a little lucky, you know, because the opportunity struck just right where he was able to do that. I mean, again, all these players can do something that level, you know, that they're pretty good when it comes to that athletic ability. But if you flash a little bit of that, people are like, oh, well, look what he could become. And they just completely throw out the fact that consistency and precision really matter so much to this position. And unless you're someone who is just so freakishly fast, so freakishly good at tracking the ball, and unbelievably smart at baiting defenders with an unusual style, I mean, you're not going to be able to lean on that athletic ability and win all the time. Even Randy Moss, who I think fits that description of what I just said, he had one of the best possession receivers in the game playing opposite him. So he benefited a little bit early on in his career in that regard.
And even Randy Moss is regarded by a lot of his peers as being one of the smartest football players around.
Exactly. And he's that exception. So like I said, he's an exception because he could do things and get away with things that the mere mortal couldn't get away with as a wide receiver. And the same way that Brett Favre could get away with things throwing the football that people say he shouldn't be able to throw the ball like that. He shouldn't be accurate doing these types of things. So, you know, Devontae Parker's not that guy. He's very good. He's a terrific athlete, but he's not that special. So in order for him to bring that out and bring out the best in him, he's going to have to see some of the things that we see from Carroo. And, you know, it's an interesting contrast that we're going to see with the Dolphins early on. So, you know, everyone, thank you for, you know, tuning in, watching this episode with Leonte Carroo. Please check out Matt Harmon's work. You'll be doing yourself a favor if you do, over at Backyard Banter. And also, of course, at NFL.com and footballguys.com. And I'm sure at a podcast near you, he is the hardest working man in show business. But I don't think he can scream like James Brown.
You would be correct.
Okay. Well, thanks again. And you guys have a good one. And see you next episode.